All right, very great. This is recording. This recorder is about ready to go out. It's very hard to get to work right now. In any video, the difficulty is not what to say, it's what not to say. Because really, anything at all could be said. How to narrow it down and speak about what's most important. One way to do that is to realize that the times we live in and realize the extreme necessity for success at this time. Not just kind of thinking about it, but actually doing it. So that rules out a whole host of approaches. We have to let those go. And what we have to do now is directly contemplate the nature of the remedy, which I have said is the effect of choosing a new idea. The idea of not trying to be prime creator gives rise to the non-modifiable effect. The effect that is not being modified. It's stable, completely equal, stable, unchanging, called unconditional love, call it perfect peace, perfect stillness, pure awareness. Any of those terms refer to the very same effect. So we need to directly contemplate this effect and see what comes from that. The first thing that I would say is that there is no greeter, and there are no gates to this experience. There's no one there greeting you, saying, come on in, what's your name, etc. There's no gate, there's no barrier whatsoever. And most importantly, this unconditional love is not asking you, who was your teacher? What lineage do you come from? What teaching did you use to get here? It's not asking that. It doesn't recognize any teaching or teacher at all. It just is. It's like a perfect reflection, like a mirror. A mirror is not asking questions about what is being reflected in it. That's not its job. So this unconditional love is not, its job is to remind us of what we really are, which is that which cannot be modified or changed. That's its only purpose. Now, we all have various approaches, but unconditional love is not concerned about our various approaches. So, the experience of unconditional love transcends any approach, transcends any teacher, transcends any teaching. Is solely concerned with enabling us to remember our true identity. That's it. And our true identity was not arrived at, was not built up, was not constructed. And the problem arises, let's say we enter into unconditional love and experience that in. Our teacher asks us, did love ask you about me? Did you recognize me? Did you say, yeah, I'm the student of such and such? And then you might be befuddled and say, no. And the teacher will say, well, how could that be a real experience then? You know. Okay, let's look out for that. In the experience of unconditional love, there is no questioning or statements about any teachers. Unconditional love overlays everything equally. No such thing as specialness. It doesn't recognize one teacher and not another. It doesn't even recognize any teachers at all, because it is the teacher. And its teaching is in its equal overlay of all. that it's present every moment equally. That is its teaching. So how could it single out a teacher? It cannot, does not. So if a teacher has an ego, they want to hear you say that, yeah, you know, unconditional love recognized you as a great teacher. But then you have to try to hear something that's not being said. And so you will, if you need to come up with that answer, give the teacher that kind of answer, you will not, you will reject the experience and look for another one. No one's ego is being recognized by unconditional love. Because ego means to something is more than something else, something is better than something else. It's a drive for more, for better, for improvement. So the ego will say in each one, am I not an improved version of something else? Am I not an improved teacher? Am I not this? But really, in the experience of unconditional love, none of those issues arise at all. So you might go back to teacher and say, no, unconditional love did not mention you at all. Didn't mention anyone. The question never arose. And as far as what's the best path to this, again, love had nothing to say about that. If it did, no path could ever reach it, because it wouldn't be effective. All spiritual paths are only effective because of what unconditional love is. It's there. It's already present. It's always been present. As soon as simultaneously with spirit choosing the idea of trying to be prime creator, the prime creator suggested to spirit that it choose the idea of not trying to be prime creator simultaneously. So the effect of that idea has always been with us. We have just ignoring it. The presence of unconditional love has always been with us in exactly the same quality at its every moment that it's always been, now, in the past, in the future, unchanging, never changing. And because that is true, there are teachers and there are teachings pointing to that experience. But the experience has always been with us and is not raising one thing above another, which is why it reminds us what we are. So it is not judging at all. It's perfect non-judgment. Not judging good, not judging bad, not judging what spiritual path is best, none of that. The best spiritual path is to focus on realizing that this experience is there and it has no judgment. But that path comes from the fact that it is there and it doesn't judge. It seems like we're in a slight paradox, but that's okay. It's not a bad one. It's not like you arrive at unconditional love and it says, oh, where'd you come from? And you say, well, I came from India. And say, oh, that's great. Who's your teacher? Well, I come from a long lineage, you know, from Adi Shankara and Vedanta and all that. And unconditional love says, wow, That's great. I'm so glad that you're here. And how long you been practicing? Oh, a long time. Oh, how wonderful. And it's not like it's all excited about and saying, wow, it's how auspicious that somebody from India on this long lineage and practicing a long time meditation, etc., has finally arrived here. What an honor, you know. It's not like that. We're not seeking honor. What we're seeking is a reminder of what we are, which is that which cannot be modified. Unconditional love is a reflection of that, reflects that to us. What we're seeking is the remembrance that reality is one. It's not parts, it's all one. So there can't be anything greater or lesser. How can it be there are not parts to it? Question arises, well, if unconditional love is completely unconcerned about how one got there, who their teachers were, what techniques they used, what teachings they used, completely zero interest, zero judgment on that, where's the motivation to teach, etc. Well, one does not really teach, one radiates assurance that this experience is there. That is the teaching. One radiates assurance that it doesn't matter how you get there, only that you get there. One radiates this assurance that this remembrance is perfect, unconditional, requiring no qualifications whatsoever, not asking about qualifications. We are pre-qualified. So that assurance is radiated. Ultimately, it's the giving up, letting go of the spiritual path that succeeds. It's the letting go of your teacher, letting go of the teachings. It's the realization that they were merely an attempt to compensate for not having this experience. They were really from the ego as well. As the ego lost strength, spiritual path arose as a feeble attempt on the ego's part to maintain authority. As Krishnamurti said, truth is a pathless land. There's no pass in truth. There's no way to get there, so to speak. So the spiritual path is still the ego. It's still saying, how can I get recognized as being better, as being superior, as being more advanced? How can I find a way? So it's kind of really in defiance of this experience of unconditional love. It's trying to offer an alternative. All spiritual paths really are offering an alternative to this experience of unconditional love, if you can accept this. Not said in a harsh way at all, but just a simple, factual way. Something to consider and feel. The feeling I have right now is not unpleasant. It's kind of shocking. But it's a pleasant type of shocking. The statements that I make on these videos tend to be in that direction. They bring about kind of a shock, but a pleasant shock. It's like a wow. I'm kind of being shocked by that statement. But it's not unpleasant. I like being shocked in this way. So I said spiritual paths are really a defiance, offering up an alternative to this experience, where the ego is still in charge. But in this experience, the ego is not in charge because there's no judgments taking place. See, the ego operates through judgment. What's more, what's less, what's bigger, what's better? Unconditional love is making no judgments of any kind. None. It's simply there. No requirements to experience it. It's not asking who is experiencing this, because it already knows. There's only reality, there's only spirit. It's spirit that's experiencing this, as a reminder. So since it already knows, it doesn't need to ask any questions or make any judgments. It doesn't need to know. Ask spirit, who is your teacher spirit? What is the path you're on, spirit? No, it knows that spirit is in reality, is one with reality, and it's the one that is experiencing this unconditional love. So, when you hear various statements on these videos, and there's different ways to take it, but the way that it's meant to be taken is a pleasant shock, like almost being stunned, but in a pleasant way. The purpose of these is to say those things. That's what I do. Say what seems to be, pleasantly shocking, almost, blasphemous. It seems like. But that's not how I want it to be taken. Because what is being said is true. So it's not blasphemous. But it is stunning to what we have conventionally believed. But what we have conventionally believed is of the ego. So it's not blasphemous to correct the mistakes of the ego. The ego thinks that some of its mistakes are less than others, which is not true. Nothing the ego gives us can remind us of what we are. Can give us that, because what we are is perfect, so we need a perfect reminder. Nothing the ego gives us is perfect. It's all modifiable. It's all a process. Again, just so that you are sure that you heard it. All spiritual paths, all spiritual teachings that we engage in is an attempt to engage in an alternative to experiencing unconditional love, perfect peace, and to feel righteous about that. And this presupposes that unconditional love is asking us to do this. We say, oh, I'm only on this spiritual path because I need to do this in order to enter into unconditional love. I need to have this path. I need to have this resume. I need to have these qualifications. I need to have this approach. But this is putting words in the mouth of unconditional love. The ego's doing that. Unconditional love is not asking any of this. It's not asking us to have a spiritual path or a spiritual approach or a spiritual teacher or teachings or disciplines or anything. It's not asking anything of us. Because it already knows what we are. And knowing what we are, it knows that we're already perfect. And we have no need of anything except this remembrance of what we are. Therefore, it knows it doesn't need to change what it is. It simply needs to remain unmodified, unchanging, unjudgmental. No such thing as more or less. No such thing as here now, but not there. It's here now, it's here everywhere. It's always here now and always here everywhere. Unchanging. Non-judgmental. Unconditional. No requirements. No qualifications. Everyone's pre-qualified. So what are we doing? Not experiencing this. Trying to qualify. Trying to meet requirements. And who is insisting on that but the ego? So the spiritual path is a temporary thing. It's what we give up. The real spiritual path is a process of giving up the spiritual path. Giving up all paths, really. Not just the spiritual path, all paths. There are no paths in unconditional love. One arrives at the experience, and there's no need to go anywhere within the experience because it's all equal. That's what's meant by there's no path. Truth is a pathless land. Krishnamurti said that very beautifully. One of the most profound statements ever made on this planet. Truth is a pathless land. And the emphasis on paths to get there is very misleading. Krishnamurti dropped the whole Order of the Star of the Theosophical Society because they were obsessed with status, spiritual status and spiritual paths. And he said, truth is a pathless land, meaning also that the emphasis on paths and spiritual status and levels, etc., was an egoic alternative. An alternative that the ego was presenting to actually experiencing the pathless land of unconditional love. Again, another shocking, pleasantly shocking statement, especially to those who have followed theosophy. But he said it, and he's right. Truth is a pathless land. Okay, let's look at that. Meaning, within the experience of unconditional love, it's equal everywhere. There's nowhere you can go within that experience where you're going to have more of it. Nowhere you can go where you can have less of it. So, there are no paths. A path is to get somewhere. Path of pilgrimage goes to a place of pilgrimage where it's supposed to have more sacred feeling there. In the land of unconditional love, the sacred feeling is everywhere, equally. Not more here or less there. So one does not have to make a path to some place. The whole idea of path is ridiculous. Everything is equally overlaid. The presence of unconditional love is present everywhere, equally, in all time, in all space, in all circumstances. So there doesn't need to be any past anywhere. When it's already there. Always already there. No such thing as status. It's not that someone is somewhere and they're getting more. And you need to make a path to where they are. Any thought of that? And one is not experiencing unconditional love. And therefore one is not remembering what one truly is. And therefore one is still trying to substitute a spiritual path for this experience. And they will believe that in doing so, they're going to get more of this experience. Or in fact, in this experience, there's no more and there's no less. There's no differentiation between who is experiencing it. Because again, unconditional love knows it's spirit that's experiencing it. And all aspects of spirit are one. No levels to it. Reality has no levels. For a while, when one is still in the grip of the ego, of course these spiritual paths will arise, and status will arise, and all these paths, you know, will arise, teachings, teachers, etc., etc. But the further one inquires, the less important all of this will become. It's a funny thing. I cannot find a teacher at this point. I've had contact with great teachers of the past, but presently, as far as in this world, I cannot find a teacher. And I keep thinking, you know, I need to find a teacher. I can't find one. Because that's the ego. The ego is saying, well, you can't go into unconditional love unless you have a teacher, a really good teacher, that you can say, as if unconditional love is going to say, where's your resume? You know, who sent you here? And I have to say, well, sensei so-and-so, roshi so-and-so, guru so-and-so, saint so-and-so, sage so-and-so, you know. I have to say, well, I was recommended that I come here by this person. And you know how it is in the world. If you go to a place that's a very high-class place or exclusive, they're going to ask, well, who are you? We don't know you. If you show up there and say, well, I was recommended by such and such, a prominent person who belongs to your group, and they'll say, ah, okay, well, very good, come on in. It's like that, isn't it, in the world? You know that it is. It's all about who you know. And if you can drop the right name, that's the ticket in to a group. And if you say, well, I just showed up here, I'm just interested, they say, well, you know, sorry, but you really have to be properly recommended and vetted, etc. So we apply that to unconditional love, thinking that we have to have someone's name we can drop, you know. We arrive in unconditional love and we expect that we're going to be asked, who sent you here? You know, what teaching, what teacher brought you here? And if we drop the right name, unconditional love, we expect it will say, ah, okay, yeah, okay, you're qualified. If that teacher sent you here, you're qualified. Come on in. And if you say, well, I don't have any teacher. I don't really have any teaching. I just want to come here and experience this. We're afraid unconditional love will look at us like, what? Really? What kind of arrogance is that? To think you can just show up here unannounced, without any introductions and recommendations? Are you crazy? Go find some teacher and get qualified, you know. That's what we expect. So every time I get to the edge of that experience, there's that, the ego says, well, how can you go experience that? You don't have a teacher. You're nuts. And that drives us. You know, so I keep trying to find a teacher. Can't find one. It's the weirdest thing. Cannot find one. It's the weirdest thing. Many times I have come across some announcement for a teacher that's going to be in the Bay Area. And I say, great. finally I'm going to get to go see a teacher and they'll recognize me and say, yeah, you're ready for the experience. I recommend you for it. And I find out that it was the previous weekend and they've just gone. This has happened over and over and over again. I miss all the teachers. And I say, oh, that's terrible. If I'd just gone to see Eckhart Tolle or something, then I would have been able to say to Unconditional Love, oh, yeah, Eckhart Tolle, I've seen him, and he, you know, maybe he said to me, yes, you are ready. You are ready for that. Go for it. But I don't have any of those, you know, recommendations. And I always thought, you know, what am I, an orphan? But now I see that's the actually unconditional love, the grace of that working for me. Because you have to let go of the teacher to get in. You have to give up the teachings and the teachers. I was a hummingbird right in front of me. Whoa, it was going right to my forehead. Holy cow. This hummingbird is hovering right in front of me right now. And I got glasses on, but it was like 6 inches in front of my forehead, pointed right at me there. Wow, I've never had that happen. Not that close. Holy cow. Whoa, that was pleasantly shocking. I didn't want him to think that my eye was a flower, you know. I have glasses on, but still, you know, I was like, wow, that was really something. Outstretched wings just hovering right in front of my face. Okay. But so if you don't have a teacher, you don't have a teaching, you don't have anything, maybe you're blessed more than anyone. Because if we have a teacher and we go to Unconditional Love and saying, hey, you know, I'm a disciple of such and such, I'm a disciple of Muji, and I'm coming here under his grace, and I'd like to come in, and then we kind of wait for a response, and there's no response. We kind of get kind of spooked and say, whoa, you know, there's no response. Maybe I need to find a better teacher, or maybe I need to get a better recommendation, so I better go back to the teacher. See? In my case, I go there, I don't have any teacher or teaching I can really 100%, you know, say it recommended me. No. I don't have any teaching I can say that directly led me here. No, I do not. Don't really have anything. And the silence remains silent. So I just remain silent and consider this. So we go from the hummingbird to the silence. Why did the hummingbird see me as a flower? I mean, that's very strange. Hummingbirds are about their business, looking for nectar. And it was looking at me like I was a flower. That was, you know, it was unnerving. And it wasn't just a brief thing. It kept coming back and just hovering, looking at directly at me. Maybe it saw me as a flower. I don't know. Again, we come to the brink of unconditional love, and there is this pleasant shock feeling. I'm feeling it right now. That's the best meditation of all. being able to bring yourself to this point and feel this kind of a dull, pleasant shock or stunned feeling. Realizing we don't need anything at all to enter into it. There are no conditions. Everything has to be set down. All questions, all medals, all honors, rewards, all status. Even the status of a path and a teacher. Because there's no status in this feeling. But that reminds us of what we really are. There's no status in reality. There's a direction to reality, but there's no status. Everything shares perfect, infinite riches, simply infinite richness. There's no teaching needed at this point. It's not like we have to apply some teaching to the experience of unconditional love. That only gets in the way. It only confuses us. We have to drop all teaching. It's the end of teaching. End of all teaching. The best, the greatest teachers are those who have no ego, require no mention of their names, which is why we mention their names, but they don't require it, completely uninterested in any of that, because they know you don't need it to drop any names, you don't need to apply any teaching to the experience. It's not as if we have experience and then we say, okay, now how do I look at this in the light of my teaching? What kind of light can my teaching shed on this? As if the purpose of experiencing this was somehow to glorify the teaching or to glorify the teacher. It's not. And paradoxically, it's those teachers that remind us, assure us of this fact, that the purpose is not to glorify them at all. Those are the ones that get glorified. Because they get out of their own way. They're not a barrier for us. They're not asking this for us to have this experience in order to glorify their name, glorify their teaching. Because there's no teacher there, no teacher needed. It's the teacher that tells us this, that go to where there's no teacher needed. That's where you have to be. Those are the ones that are mentioned and glorified. Go to the place where there's no teacher needed, no teaching needed, no student needed. No devotee needed. And experience this pleasant shock in the hearing of this. Don't let it get mental on you. I feel the shock like in the core of my body, so to speak. Don't let any teaching get mental on you or emotional on you, either one, neither heart nor head. But rather this place. unpleasant feeling of being stunned or shocked. Just abide in that, because that is really like a precursor or a way of entering across the so-called barrier, invisible barrier, realizing that everything else before this wasn't really needed. You're giving up everything. You don't need anything. You come in empty. That's a marvelously shocking feeling. It's growing right now. Nothing mental to it. Nothing emotional to it. We all crave this. We want to get there, but we don't feel that it's justified for us in our case, but I'm telling you it is. Actually, people drink themselves. They drink to feel this, kind of this feeling, trying to approximate it, feeling that they don't have to do anything. Why? Because they're drunk. It's a vague similarity to it. I can see that people will, because this truth is unvalidated in this world to such an extent, we crave it, we want to get there, but it's so unvalidated that we will have to offer up substitutes, and alcohol is one of those substitutes. Of course, it has tremendous drawbacks and side effects, whereas this does not. I don't feel impaired in any way. You see, when a culture and a world invalidates truth, we still want it, but we end up accepting substitutes for it. The world will say, here, have a beer, have some liquor, get drunk, have some drugs, let's legalize all drugs. That's what the world's going towards. Substitutes. The ego offers up substitutes for this feeling. This feeling is the feeling of drawing close to unconditional love. And I'm feeling that there's this pleasant shock. I go, wow, I don't need to do anything. I don't need to have any teaching. I don't need to remember anything. I don't need even to remember who my teacher was. I don't even have to have a teacher. I don't have to have anything. I don't have to have any money or status. Or let go of any money or status. What I am in existence makes no difference. Completely irrelevant. I'm welcome just as I am here. In fact, what I am is completely overlooked here. There's no judgment, zero. All of this is a shocking realization. But it's pleasant. But if a culture and a world denies all this, it's in the grips of the ego. You will be frightened of this, feel that somehow you're wrong and wicked. And then you'll ask the ego, what do I do? And the ego will say, well, go get drunk. That'll help you. So what I'm doing is I'm validating this for everyone. It's a little step. It's not the whole culture validating it. At least it's a point of validation, an area of validation, a stream of validation. You can tune into it. Because really, what do teachers teach you? Nothing. They teach you that they're not a teacher. They teach you that they have nothing to give you. And that's okay. They teach you that that's okay because the experience of unconditional love is what is there for us. And that's the teacher. Teachers, the best teachers are the ones who say there is no such thing as a teacher. There are no teachers. It's only this experience of unconditional love with no requirements of you. You're pre-qualified. And again, the best teacher says there is no teaching. No teacher, no teaching. And when we really hear this, there's a stunned feeling. But again, don't try to bring about an artificially stunned feeling. And then thinking that you're getting it. That's what the ego will do. Have you use drugs and various other ways to try and bring about this feeling and say, oh, you see, you can get this through manipulating and modification. No. That's not the way. Because that's as far as it goes, and you will get addicted to the means to try and arrive at this type of feeling. It never goes beyond that. Because the ego will recognize everything right up to the point of actually experiencing the experience, but it will not recognize the experience, because that experience denies the ego entirely, but it's no judgment. There's all sorts of activity going on here. There are people walking down the street. I just saw a couple of cats coming into the yard, moving around. There are birds building nests. They're grabbing pieces of various building materials for nests all around. There's insects whizzing all over the place. There's that hummingbird that suddenly arrived right in front of me. There's the breeze. Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful day. Made even more beautiful by arriving at this place. Oh, there's another bird right in front of me. What? Different kind of bird. Flew right up. Very close. He's looking at right at me there. As a matter of fact, a bird flew in our house yesterday. We don't know how it got in necessarily. May have got in one door and flew through the kitchen into the living room, and I trapped it in a basket against the window and then put a lid on the basket and took it outside. It was fluttering all over the place. It sees through the window and thinks that it should be able to fly, and it keeps hitting the window. Cannot recognize the window. That's like someone taking drugs and thinking that they're close to truth. Not realizing there's this barrier there of clarification. They lack the clarification. They're only aiming for the effect. But this effect comes about through clarification. Again, the ego cannot recognize unconditional love. It can only recognize the effect of getting close to it. but not any further than that. And so it will make that an end in itself. The feeling that people get through drugs is similar. But this is much milder than any of that end. It's different. Doesn't have any side effects. It's taking place of its own accord. Simply through contemplating these truths. Another bird, a different kind, right here. Hello, bird, that's the one I rescued yesterday. Oh my gosh, it's right in front of me now. Just hello. How are you? Remember me? 16 inches away on a little wire. Huh. My gosh. Kind of Grand Central Station here. I used to have a blue jay that would show up and just contemplate me. It would get very, very close, just sit there and just stare at me. And as long as I stood there, it would just keep staring at me. It wouldn't move. That happened over and over and over again. Very unusual for a bird not to be about its business. I'm carrying out this satsang. Why? You may ask. Why is it so long? Why? Because we're not going mental here. I don't want you to go mental. I'm just feeling this feeling. Not an emotion. There's no emotion to it at all. None. Sort of a deep-seated ache or stunness or shockness. Numbness almost, and based on realization that of the various things we've been talking about and just seeing, you know, how it goes. I feel fine. Not impaired in any way. There's another bird. And you need to be in a place where you feel it's okay to feel this way. Where you don't have to engage in conversation much. Don't have to do anything, go anywhere. Just sitting. That's why sitting quietly is the best. You don't have to be in any yogic postures. You can if you want to. But that's not an end in itself. I'm just sitting here. On a bench. Outdoors and beautiful day. And my work is done. I don't need to do anything. And so I can just get into this feeling. Get into this stunned feeling. Shock. Shock of recognition. I'm sure I could drive. It's not a problem. I wouldn't be, you know, so immersed in this feeling if I was driving. It would quickly kind of be compartmentalized. But I don't find that there's not the slightest trouble in driving. There's no impairment of senses or motor responses or anything like that. This is deeper than that. It's like a reverberation. Something shocking is reverberating. continues on. Things is like things have been turned upside down. But really, we've heard all this before. Just when it becomes very focused, that it carries with it a real wallop. Really, all the teachers, their only purpose is to tell you, you don't need a teacher. You need this experience. It's the ego that tries to substitute teachers for this experience. And the real teachers, they have to arise for us as teachers, because that's what we're demanding, you see. The ego demands this, that we have teachers. So those who would tell us that we don't need teachers have to appear in the guise of teachers. And this they do. So the world may recognize them as teachers, but if you listen to them, what they say really will be, look, you don't need any teacher. No teacher is needed whatsoever. And there are no teachers. You don't need a teaching. There is no teaching needed. They just assure us that this experience is there. Unconditional love is there. They reassure us of that. That's the real help. Not any teaching, not any teacher. And their reassurance comes from themselves experiencing it and knowing that this is the teacher. This experience is the only teacher and teaching there is. All of this contrary to the ego's teachings and beliefs. Completely contrary to it. So this stunned feeling is this feeling of the ego losing its grip on us. And again, the ego will tell us that it can give us a way to lose its grip on us, and we'll go get drunk, and we feel the ego's lost its grip on us. It's not true. It only seems that way temporarily. Accept no substitutes. There go the cats. They're filtering out of the yard now, moving through quietly, like as if it were a jungle. All this play continues on here. But we don't need to be aware of any of it, or unaware of any of it. Simply realize that the overlay is present. Experience the overlay. The unconditional love, no conditions, zero. Just need to keep telling ourselves that zero conditions. We're already pre-qualified perfectly. We don't need to go on a pilgrimage somewhere. Or we don't need to stop a pilgrimage that we're on. We don't need to get a teacher. We don't need to get rid of the teacher we have. Nothing needs to take place. No change needs to take place in order for us to experience this. We're already perfectly qualified. It means we don't have to. Nothing we can do or not do makes any difference in that fact. Doesn't matter what we've done, doesn't matter what we've left undone. Doesn't matter how long we've been deceived, how quick we've arrived. Unconditional love is not going to ask us, how long did it take you to get here? It's not even interested in that. How many years have you been working on this? Won't even ask that. You see, it's just as willing that we never spend an instant on it as it is if we spend a trillion years on it. No difference. It's only a perfect mirror. Perfect mirror's job is to be a perfect mirror, not to judge who's looking in the mirror, because it knows it's reflecting the truth of what we are. And it will always be a perfect mirror. So it makes no difference whether someone looks in that perfect mirror now or a trillion years from now. It'll be exactly the same reflection. One might say it's a timeless mirror, then. It's making no judgments on time, one way or the other. It's not asking us to look at it now or to look at it some other time. It's making no judgment, no time-based judgments at all. And here again is another layer of shock. You might call this satsang shock treatment. This is the real shock treatment. This is the gentle, pleasant shock treatment. The problem is, we'll go back and ask the ego, "Is this okay, ego?" And of course, the ego is going to say, "Oh, no, it's not okay. You're a little bit off track here. Let me get you back on track." That's what will happen. We know that. That's the trouble. So it's very important to deepen this gentle shock treatment and feel it. Just stay with the feeling. Don't try to make it more. Don't try to make it less. Whatever's there, just let it be there. There's no part of this that can be taken and brought back. It's not like you can find a hero and the hero will go there and then bring it back to you. No, what the hero does is simply radiate the assurance that it's there for everyone, without qualifications, without conditions. It's already present everywhere, omnipresent, perfectly, perfect quality, flawless, unmodifiable quality. It's there, without any conditions. It's not bringing it back. It's saying it's already here. It's everywhere. It's nowhere it can be. Nowhere it can be brought from and to. It cannot be brought from this place to this place because it's already in every place. And it's seamless. You cannot cut out a part of it, like a thing, and bring it somewhere. And hoard it, or pass it out. It's not like that someone can have this and pass it out to others. That's the ego that believes that. Of course, the ego believes in fragmentation, and having something more and less, and quantities and all that, which is forgetfulness of what we are. Effective satsang is not a 5-minute thing. You need to let this feeling, this shocked feeling, pleasant, shocked, let that deepen, let it be there. Just ride it. It's like a wave. Just ride the wave. Don't kick out of the wave. Ride it all the way to shore. And then sit down there quietly. I remember riding some big waves, and after you finish the ride, you just want to sit there on your board and not move, not go after another wave, really. Just let the whole experience reverberate and just feel that, wow, that was really a ride. That was quite a ride. Don't be mental, don't go on the next thing. Just kind of feel that. It's like we've just turned everything around. The inside out is now right side in. The backwards is now forwards. This reversal has taken place, and we're just simply sitting here saying, wow, what happened? So I don't know, it feels good though, it feels pleasant shock. And the main thing is that we're validating all this. Both the speaker and the listener are validating it. And validation opens up the door, so to speak. Because if it's invalidated, we'll accept a substitute. We'll grab a hold of a substitute. Everyone in this world is grabbing hold of substitutes, clutching at straws. Because the validation for this has been diminished. People say, well, there's no attack on religion, there's no attack on this. Well, say what one will. But there is a massive attack on validation, validating what's being said here. It's a subtle thing. Because the ego doesn't recognize it. The more we've placed authority in the ego's hands, the more this becomes invalidated. What is said here becomes invalidated, white, which is why it's so difficult to say it now. Very difficult. A lot of stress involved. Sometimes my voice will just almost drop away. Because the expectations of society weigh heavily on us. More heavy than we realize. I remember when I was young and the pressure of society caused me to lose a sense of validation for truth. And after a while, I think I was maybe 19 or so, I lay down on the floor and said, okay, let me just drop all this invalidation and get right back to truth. I'm going to speak truth now. Because when I was young, I was speaking it. And then the pressure of the world, the invalidation of it, became so extreme that it eventually destabilized. I was unable to speak the truth clearly. So I lay down on the floor and said, okay, I'm going to speak, I'm going to just toss this away, the invalidation away, and speak the truth. And what I found was this enormous wave of panic and dread hit me. And I said, what and where in the world did that come from? And we all faced this. What it was this massive upsurge of invalidation, telling you, you can't say that, you can't do that. It'll be disastrous for you if you do. It'll be a terrible thing. Don't do it, all of this. Well, what we fear is the ego will drop away and we'll have no advisor. But consider this. What kind of advice can the ego give us that the experience of unconditional love doesn't give us? Because experience of unconditional love, we realize that's all we need. That's what we need. It's remembrance of what we are is what we need. The ego can't do that. And we don't really need the ego to remember what we are. We only need the ego to forget what we are. And of course, the ego tells us that this forgetting of what we are is some kind of a part of a divine plan, and that we must go along with it, which is a lie. So we're afraid if we drop the ego, we'll not have any advisor as how to advance upon this so-called divine plan of evolving consciousness or something. It's absolute nonsense. That's a trick of the ego. Unconditional love reminds us of what we already are. We don't need to become something different than what we are already are. We simply need to drop all efforts to become something different than what we already are. See, we don't need to succeed at becoming different than what we are. We need to drop the efforts to succeed at becoming something different than what we are. Let go of illusions of what we are. Let go of misperception of what we are. Even let go of perception of what we are, because perception itself is a distortion. So I'm just giving time here, you see, for people to feel, the viewer to feel this shock. And it's very important. And this is not said in a mean-spirited or judgmental way at all. But it's very important not to be on drugs when you're in satsang. Because that's the substitute the ego is offering you. And the ego is saying, hey, you're getting this because of this, you know, caffeine or this drug or that drug or something. And you'll get confused, very confused. Whereas if you're not on anything at all, no drugs of any kind, if you have a severe condition, like high blood pressure, diabetes, whatever, you need to be on medication, of course, whatever you need to be on. But I mean a drug that you don't need to keep your life going. A mood drug. It's very important not to be on any mood drug. That includes caffeine. Very, very important when you're in satsang, when you're listening. Very crucial. So then you will know that this feeling is coming from clarification and the shock of clarification, and you're really on track. You'll know it. There's no doubt about it. And it will feel right to you. It's not a jangle. You won't feel jangled at all. I don't feel the slightest bit jangled, you know. It's very calm. Still feel very calm. Very alert, calm, no problems at all. So satsang gives you the time to just feel this. Just get comfortable with it. Like I said, it's not a 5-minute thing. Insight can be a 5-minute thing. Satsang is a longer thing. If you feel you have the time to mellow out with this feeling, get used to it, then you will get into it. You'll clarify and you'll see. And you say, aha, and this will reverberate. Still reverberating with me here. And if you just do a 5-minute thing, there's no time for this to really settle in and for you to experience it and get familiar with it and feel comfortable. Get your comfort zone there. There's no time for that. You know, you're off to the next thing. You click off to something else. So it's really a service here to all to present these longer satsangs. As tedious as it may sound, if you're mental, it will be tedious. Don't think you've got to grab something mentally so much. Recognition, yes, is through reason and clarification. You'll recognize, you'll see something, and that'll produce this shock. Oh my gosh. All of this, everything I've ever done, has just been the ego substitute for this experience. It's always been here. I've been missing it all along. You know, stuff, recognitions will come. That reverberates, and then you have the time to settle in with that. As you view a satsang, like for instance Muji's satsangs, the long ones, very effective, a couple hours, 2.5-3 hours. People are just sitting there quietly. Nobody, you know, it's supposed to be silent, meaning no conversation going on. And that gives everybody the feeling they can settle into this deep, shocked, pleasant, shocked feeling. and not have to converse with anybody, or, you know, don't need to. And they have plenty of time to let this happen for them. There's no place they need to go, nothing they need to do. They just continue to sit there. Those are the real parameters of success. Again, and no drugs, no mood-altering substance whatsoever. Both before the satsang, during the satsang, and after the satsang. Now, of course, you'll probably slip back into, you know, whatever habits you have, but you have to at least make that effort prior, during, and post, so that you get a clear experiencing that this is coming, the shock is coming from realization and not from anything else, and you're getting comfortable with that. It's not if you're like a coffee drinker, you have to, you know, give it up, because a lot of people, they just won't. Or if you're a smoker or whatever you do. But you do have to set aside these blocks of time where you're not doing that. So you feel the real thing. You don't have to go back to immediately, you know, get the high of a coffee or something. Yeah, so the ego will tell you that to compare. Say, you need to compare, which is better. You know, that kind of thing. Don't need to do that. See, the ego's obsessed with saying that it's better than what it has, is better than what the God has provided for us, Prime Creator has provided, this unconditional love. The ego's obsessed with saying it, what it has is better. So it insists that you compare, in quote-unquote fairness to the ego. But again, the ego's purpose is to forget what we are. So in fairness to truth, we have to say that fairness is not an issue at all. It's different purposes. So if we choose to remember what we are, then fairness means we remain focused on remembering what we are. That's fair to that purpose. The ego's claims we're not being fair to it, its purpose, is ridiculous, because we've chosen a different purpose. You cannot have both of those purposes fairly treated, because each one is a total direction. It's a direction. You cannot go in two opposite directions at once. And if you're going, you go one direction for a little ways, then you turn around and go retrace your steps and go another direction, and turn around, retrace your steps. You're not being fair to either direction, because you're not going anywhere. So the issue of fairness is not one that can be resolved ever. So it's not an issue. What is unfair is that the ego insists that it is the only purpose there can be. And that's being unfair to truth, that's being unfair to ourselves. It's essentially a claim that we can just have no purpose. You know, it's ultimately the ego is really asking us to be nothing. The ego says if we don't follow its purpose, we have nothing. We're nothing. So the ego says you can either choose to follow its purpose or be nothing at all. That's the choice the ego gives you. Unconditional love is not asking us to compare this experience with some other experience, because it's perfectly suited for its purpose. We would only be looking for something else that's better suited for this purpose, and there isn't. There's only this one effect. There's no other. The ego has a different purpose, so it wouldn't be a question of fairness. It would be a question of choosing a different purpose. See, the ego very cleverly sees it as a question of fairness, thinking that somehow that this experience of unconditional love is some means to achieve the ego's purpose. And the ego will say, well, in fairness, we need to compare it with some other means to achieve the same purpose, just to see how this stacks up, not realizing, unable to recognize this is actually an effect from a different purpose, different idea. So the only reason we would try to choose experience something else is if this unconditional love asked us, why don't you compare this with some other means to reach the same goal? But unconditional love won't ask that, because it's the only means to reach the goal. It's the perfect reflection of what we are. It's non-modification. It's perfect non-modification. How could there be anything better than that? Think about that. Unconditional love, not being changed in any way, equally present everywhere. How can there be an improvement on that? How can there be improvement on 100%? That's the whole point of it, isn't it? How can there be improvement of what we are, spirit? There cannot be. Our identity is primary. There's no improvement needed. So there isn't some other way that's better, or some other way that's not quite as good. It's not like there's an experience of perfect non-modification, except in some instances it's being modified. No such thing. And that could not remind us of what we are anyway. Anyway, we've reached a point now where we can see that there's a little bit of additional work to do, but we will leave that for another time. It's sufficient that we have experienced some grip of truth upon us, some grip of realization, like, oh my gosh, here we go. All I need to do is step into that. And the feeling like, oh, this is going to be incredible, really. And maybe down the road we'll talk about, clarify a little more, that there's no need to compare it. We've touched upon it, but we have not got it to the point where it's going to produce a real strong realization. All right. We'll put an end to this satsang. Remember to not go into any of the ego's means of modification, mood modification. Give yourself another couple hours at least. Maybe the rest of the day. And you may not remember what was said here, but what's even more important than what was said was that you've experienced this pleasant, shocked feeling. Sensation, a stunned feeling, very pleasant, stunning. Didn't cause any problem. This is a dissipation of the fear and the panic. It's a sense of validation, starting to feel validated. Whenever we can get to this feeling directly, genuinely, not trying to use any drugs or modification, mood modifiers or anything like that, you get to it actually and directly, the wave of panic is subsiding. Man, we're getting ever so close to actually experiencing this unconditional love, which is the sole means to remember what we really are. All right, very great. That's it.